الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا، أما بعد. Dear respective brothers and sisters, inshallah ta'ala, in these lessons we want to cover some extracts from the kitab Al-Da'u wa-Dawa of Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah ta'ala. And the reason why, brothers and sisters, I picked this kitab is because how many of us, brothers and sisters, today are suffering from sins that we are really, really struggling with to remove from our lives? And here Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah ta'ala, he brings us many different ways and means to rid ourselves from these sins that has destroyed many of us, our family members. And inshallah, I will mention also the reason as to why this book was authored. But before that, brothers and sisters, if there is any month that we can try and change, then it is the month of Ramadan, where the scene has been set for us. The bi'ah, the environment, has been made very, very easy for a person to change. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he told us in a hadith, إِذَا دَخَلَ شَهْرُ Ramadan, فُتِّحَتْ أَبْوَابُ الْجَنَّةِ. When the month of Ramadan enters, the doors of Jannah are swung open. وَغُلِّغَتْ أَبْوَابُ النَّارِ. And the doors of the hellfire are slammed shut. وَسُلْسِلَةِ الشَّيَاطِينَ. And the shayateen have been changed, they've been locked up. The scene has been set for us to change and to try and become better Muslims. So, brothers and sisters, let us not be horrible to those who might enter into the masjid only in the month of Ramadan. You find two types of people. The individual who walks into the month of Ramadan and he wants to use it as a stepping stone. And it's very sad to say that sometimes we see this individual and we belittle him. And we say this person only comes into the masjid in the month of Ramadan, when the reality of the matter is trying to change. He's trying to become a better person by using this month, which has made it easier for a person to become a better Muslim. But then you have the other type of person who, just because it's Ramadan, he decides to do good deeds, while at the same time he has the intention after the month of Ramadan, he carries on with his bad habits. He carries on with the filth that he might be involved in. So brothers and sisters, inshallah ta'ala, let's try to the best of our abilities to work as much as we can in this month in trying to purify our hearts. Throughout the year, because of the type of environment that we are in, brothers and sisters, you find that our hearts become so blackened. Why? Everywhere we look, we find haram. And every time we see haram, you find that a black dot is placed on a person's heart. As the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he told us in the famous hadith, until the heart becomes blackened from top to bottom, and every time he sees a ma'roof, he doesn't recognize it, and every time he sees a munkar, he falls into it. Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah ta'ala, he mentions that the asal of the evil, the origin of evils, it goes back to two things. Al-fudulu fil kalami wal-fudulu fil nadar. An excess in speaking and also an excess of nadar, looking at things that are not permissible for us. Subhanallah, brothers and sisters, just look at this jawal, sometimes even unintentionally. Wherever we serve, wherever we look, there's always maybe something that we shouldn't be looking at ends up hitting the eye. And in some cases, you find that we go out our way in order to look at these things that are muharram, until subhanAllah, the heart becomes so black. Why is the heart, brothers and sisters, so important for us to purify and to look after? The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he told us in a hadith, أَلَا وَإِنَّ فِي الْجَسَدِ مُضْغَةً إِذَا صَلَحَتْ صَلَحَ الْجَسَدُ كُلُّهُ وَإِذَا فَسَدَتْ فَسَدَ الْجَسَدُ كُلُّهُ أَلَا وَهِيَ الْقَلْبُ. For indeed, there's a piece of flesh in a person's body, that if that becomes rectified, everything else becomes rectified. If that becomes corrupt, everything else becomes corrupt. Let us not be surprised as to why sometimes the actions that we do, we don't even necessarily realize the evil that which is coming out of it. It goes back to the asr, which is the heart. Ask yourselves, brothers and sisters, how many hours a day do we spend in the gym? And I think I've mentioned this before here as well. How many hours do we spend in the gym trying to perfect our outer appearance? 7 hours, 8 hours, trying to bring out adalat, muscles, because we want to look good for everybody else. How many hours, our sisters, do we look in the mirror every morning? To such an extent that we might carry the mirror, right? Every couple of hours we take out the mirror to see how our outer appearance looks in front of the creation. We spend hundreds of pounds with regards to makeup. This is very well known, the sisters know this. Just trying to perfect the outer appearance. Imagine if we just gave an hour of that, brothers and sisters, to trying to rectify the heart. That which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to be looking at, as the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَنْظُرُ إِلَىٰ سُوَرِكُمْ وَإِلَىٰ أَجْسَادِكُمْ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't look at your bodies, your outer appearances. وَلَكِنْ يَنْظُرُ إِلَىٰ خُلُوبِكُمْ وَإِلَىٰ أَعْمَالِكُمْ. But rather Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He looks at your hearts and at your actions as well. The reason why, brothers and sisters, this book was authored, and the Shaykh, the Imam Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah ta'ala, he placed this in the beginning of his book. He quotes and he says, مَا تَخُولُ السَّادَةُ الْعُلَمَاءُ أَئِمَّةُ الدِّينِ. This is a questioner asking a question to Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah ta'ala. رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُمْ أَجْمَعِينَ. Asking him, what do the leaders and the scholars say about this matter, the أِمَّةُ الدِّينِ, the leaders of Islam, the religion. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be pleased with them. في رجل ابتلي ببلية. With regards to a man who has been trialed with a calamity. وعلم أنها إن استمرت به أفسدت عليه دنياه وآخرته. And he knows that if he carries on and continues in his situation that he's in, it will end up corrupting his dunya and likewise the akhirah. وَخَدْ اجْتَهَدَ فِي دَفْعِهَا. And he has strived very, very hard in trying to ward this away from his life. بِكُلِّ طَرِيقٍ, in every single way possible. فَمَا تَزْدَادُ إِلَّا تَوَقُّدًا وَشِدَّةً. And every time he tries, he increases in more severity and in more sin. فَمَا الْحِيلَةُ فِي دَفْعِهَا. What is the trick in trying to remove this or to push this away? وَمَا التَّرِيخُ إِلَىٰ كَشْفِهَا. And what is the means or the ways in order to uncover this? فَرَحِمَ اللَّهُ مَنْ أَعَانَ مُبْتَلًا. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have mercy upon the individual who aids, assists a person who has been trialed in his life. والله في عون العبد ما كان العبد في عون أخيه. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is in the aid of his servant as long as he is in the aid of his brothers and sisters. أفتون مأجورين. So he asked him for a fatwa in order to maybe change his life around. So then the Shaykh subhanallah, you find that he ended up writing a whole book in how to rid ourselves from the sins that a person might be drowning in. Our Shaykh, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless him, when he was teaching the book, Shaykh Abdul Razak al-Badr, he mentioned that it seems like this individual was somehow maybe drowning in a type of sin that he became so attached to. And it might have been even infatuation. Where is deep ishq, a deep type of infatuation? It could have been that he was so attached to a woman, and because of this he was falling into haramat, and every time he tried to stop himself from it, he couldn't stop himself from it. It might be because this individual, he keeps having these imaginations of this haram, and because of this is leading from one thing to another. Brothers and sisters, wallahi, whether we know it or not, there's types of trials and calamities today that even people who are practicing are suffering from. And I won't shy away from mentioning it. As Umm Salama radiallahu ta'ala anha, she said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَسْتَحِي مِنَ الْحَقِّ فَهَلْ عَلَى الْمَرَأَةِ الْغُسْلُ إِذَا احْتَلَمَتْ قَالَ نَعْمِ ضَرَأَةٍ مَا. متفق عليه. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not shy from the truth. The amount of emails and messages, brothers and sisters, that I receive on a regular basis of some of them being practicing brothers who have maybe been trialed and become so addicted to looking at images that they shouldn't be looking at muharramat. It's become so part of their lives, they can't detach themselves away from it. I had emails come to me from Canada where there were some Somali brothers saying that they were trying to get married, but because of the muhur, the dowry being so high up, the parents wouldn't allow them. So what did they end up reverting to? Watching pornography, doing things with themselves that they shouldn't be doing, to such an extent that some of them, they just couldn't carry on with their lives. And as the questioner is saying, he knows that if he carries on being drowned in these sins, is going to corrupt his dunya and likewise his akhirah. And the one who contemplates and ponders and really looks deep into the ayat and the hadith of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and then looks at the situation of the people, wallahi, will realize that a person will go through this type of alienation and estrangement to his Lord. He begins to feel cold till he feels that the whole dunya is coming down upon him. And it all goes back to the fact that this individual is drowning into sins. And there is asbab, inshaAllah ta'ala, that I want to go through, maybe next week or the following week, of some of the effects of the sins and what it does to a person. Also, what we benefit from this, brothers and sisters, is as-sa'i fi qada'i hawa'ij an-nas, taking time out in order to help the people. Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah ta'ala could have easily said, I'm really busy at this moment in time, and not get back to this individual. You can imagine now how many people are contacting Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah ta'ala, who was an imam in his time. But then he ended up writing a whole book with a question that came to him. Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah ta'ala, his teacher was also like this. The Risala al-Hamawiyyah, which people take sometimes years to study, he wrote it between Dhuhr and Asr. Why? لِأَنَّ صَاحِبَهَا كَانَ يَنْتَظِرُهَا. The one who asked him to write this risala was waiting for it. They really, really took their time out to help the people. You know, subhanAllah, brothers and sisters, those who may have been involved in this can relate to this. Sometimes helping the people in their needs and some of the difficulties that they're going through is one of the ways to sometimes really soften up your heart. And you begin to feel some sort of satisfaction in your heart because you're taking time out in order to help this person. Even though you know sometimes you might be busy. Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah ta'ala and Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah ta'ala, he mentioned this in Rawdatul Muhibbin. He says, كَانَ Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah ta'ala يَسْعَى فِي قَضَاءِ حَوَائِجِ النَّاسِ. He used to go out his way, Ibn Taymiyyah, his teacher, talking about his teacher, in trying to help the people's needs. سَعْيًا شَدِيدًا, quite extensively. لِأَنَّهُ يَعْلَمُ, he knows that if he goes out his way to help others, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will help him when he's in need. Why the hadith? وَاللَّهُ فِي عَوْنِ الْعَبْدِ مَا كَانَ الْعَبْدُ فِي عَوْنِ أَخِيهِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is in the aid and the assistance of his servant as long as he helps and goes out and assists others as well. Sometimes we think to ourselves, this guy only calls me when he needs me, right? And we look down on this type of thing. Rather, brothers, it's a noble thing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed you in a position where you help the people. And you have the opportunity to gain so much reward. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what did he say? أَحَبُّ النَّاسِ إِلَى اللَّهِ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى أَنْفَعُهُمْ. The most beloved amongst the people to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are those who are what? Most beneficial to the people. It came in another hadith where the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, أَفْضَلُ الْأَعْمَالِ إِلَى اللَّهِ. The most beloved action to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is
سرور تدخله في أخيك في أخيك المؤمن. A happiness that you enter into a person. The fact that an individual now becomes happy due to you doing something for him is from the most best and beloved great actions to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he mentioned a couple of examples. جُوعٌ تَطْرُدُهُ مِنْ مُسْلِمٍ. A hunger that a person is going through, that he's enduring, that you remove this away from him, was one of the things that were mentioned. And then the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he mentioned, it is more beloved to him to go and help somebody else than spending i'tikaf for a whole month. Than doing i'tikaf for a whole month. As the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, this is the manzila, brothers and sisters, of helping out others. And this is exactly what these scholars after them, like Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah ta'ala, Ibn al-Qayyim, they tried their utmost best to imitate. Because knowing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to go and help them. Jabir radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he said, مَا سُئِلَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ عَنْ شَيْءٍ قَطْ فَقَالَ لَا. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was never asked of anything and he ever said no. I had all my notes on the iPad, but it just switched off. Today, inshallah ta'ala, brothers and sisters, I picked out a chapter from the chapters of this immense, great book called Ad-Da'u wa Ad-Dawa, The Medicine and Its Cure. And also because it's munasib, it is quite relevant because we are in the month of Ramadan, and that is pertaining ad-du'a. That is pertaining ad-du'a. And the manzila, the status it has in our religion, and how this really, really, brothers and sisters, if we implement it into our lives, how we can change it for the better. Something that we might not necessarily look high upon, or we think to ourselves, it doesn't necessarily mean anything big. Wallahi, brothers and sisters, الدُّعَاءُ سِلَاحُ الْمُؤْمِنِ. The supplication that a person does is the weapon of the mu'min, the believer. And it takes sometimes one instance or one incident to take place in your life. And that you, because you made a dua, you find the response of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make your thiqah billahi azza wa jal, the authenticity, the trust that you have in Allah azza wa jal, soar up into the skies. And we can only do this if we know the manzila and maybe how to get our ad'i answered. The reason why I picked this, brother and sister, we are in a month which is a month that one should be making a lot of dua. The issue of a dua has an attachment to the month of Quran. It has significance. If you look at Surah Al-Baqarah, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, شهر رمضان الذي أنزل فيه القرآن, where he talks about the verses of الصيام. What is the next verse that came? وَإِذَا سَأَلَكَ عِبَادِي عَنِّي عَفْوًا يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الصِّيَامُ كَمَا كُتِبَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. Then he says, شهر رمضان, until the end of the ayah. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, وَإِذَا سَأَلَكَ عِبَادِي عَنِّي فَإِنِّي قَرِيبٌ. And when my servant, he asks about me, I am very close. Then the following ayah, أُحِلَّ لَكُمْ لَيْلَةُ الصِّيَامِ الرَّفَثُ. The next ayah talks about siyam. So you find that this ayah that is speaking about a dua and asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has been sandwiched by all these other verses pertaining to siyam. So it's a month where one should be doing a lot of dua. It came in another hadith where the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, ثَلَاثَةٌ لَا تُرَدُّ دَعْوَتُهُمْ. Three people won't have the dua rejected. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam started off by saying, دَعْوَةُ الْمَظْلُومِ. First one is the dua, the supplication of the person who's been oppressed. The second one, الصائم حتى يفطر. The one who's fasting until he breaks it. We look all the time, brothers and sisters, at the month of Ramadan as a balwa, as a calamity coming our way, 19 hours, 18 hours. How am I going to fast that? It's an opportunity that other people may not have, where we can make dua for 18 hours to ask Allah Azza wa Jalla to remove all the difficulties and problems and calamities that we are suffering from. Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah ta'ala, he mentioned something in this book pertaining to dua, and he says, وَمِنْ أَنْفَعِ الْأَدْوِيَةِ, and from the most beneficial of medicines, cures, الْإِلْحَاحُ فِي الدُّعَى, is that one, he really breaks down and is consistently asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in his dua. These are from the things that will cure the problem of the sa'il and anybody else who is maybe suffering from these sins, suffering from these problems, an infatuation, a sin that he might be attached to and he can't get away from it. Al-ilhahu fi du'a, for a person to make du'a and at the same time continuously ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in humility. He also says, Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah ta'ala, وَالدُّعَاءُ مِنْ أَنْفَعِ مَا يَكُونَ وَهُوَ عَدُوُ الْبَلَاءِ. The dua is from the most beneficial of what a person can ever do. وَهُوَ عَدُوُ الْبَلَاءِ, and it is the enemy of the trial that hits a person. يُدَافِعُهُ وَيُعَالِجُهُ. What does it do? It removes it and it also cures it. وَيَمْنَعُ نُزُولَهُ, and the dua, it prevents a calamity coming down a person, a trial coming down a person. وَيَرْفَعُهُ, and after a person may have been afflicted, it raises it up again, it removes it. أَوْ يُخَفِّفُهُ إِذَا نَزَلْ, and if a person has been afflicted, what does it do? It lightens it. If the calamity that he has now is such a major issue, what the dua can do, it can lighten it for him, can make his situation much easier. وَقَدْ رَوَى إِبْنُ مَاجَ رَحِمُ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى مِنْ حَدِيثِ أَبِي هُرَيْرَةَ that the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم said, مَنْ لَمْ يَسْأَلِ اللَّهَ يَغْضَبْ عَلَيْهِ, whoever doesn't ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then Allah subhanahu becomes angry at him. Look at the difference, brothers and sisters, between the creation and also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We, the creation, the human being, hates to be asked. We don't like people asking us. أَلَيْسَ كَذَلِكَ. Most of us will testify to this. And when we do get asked, we come up maybe with 100 excuses. But look at Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't get bored from you constantly asking Him. Rather, He loves for you to ask Him. Maybe it is, brothers and sisters, that we, as soon as we are hit with a calamity, why is it that we always run to the creation? The creation who sometimes maybe belittles us, right? Looks down on us. And this one favor that he might do for us, he will bring it up for the next 10 years. أنا فعلت لك كذا وفعلت لك كذا وفعلت لك كذا. I done this for you, I done this for you, I done that for you. But maybe one supplication, if we follow these etiquettes that I'm about to mention now, inshallah ta'ala, where your dua will rarely ever be rejected, wallahi, you will reach a level, brothers and sisters, in your life that you are in need of nobody. Anytime you need something, the first person that you run to is Allah Azza wa Jal. So he says, وَإِذَا جَمَعَ الدُّعَاءُ حُذُورَ الْقَلْبِ. If a person now combines with regards to his supplication, حُذُورَ الْقَلْبِ, his heart is present. وَجَمْعِيَتَهُ بِكُلِّيَتِهِ, and he also goes into this dua that he's making full-heartedly, not a half-hearted dua where he thinks, oh no, you know, let me just see if this works. He goes into it boldly, brothers and sisters. وَصَادَفَ وَقْتًا مِنْ أَوْقَاتِ الْإِجَابَةِ, and this time that he's making dua, he ends up being at a time what is from the times where the dua is accepted. Yes, I might make a dua at any time and my dua gets accepted, but there is other times, brothers and sisters, that if a person was to make dua, it is arja. It is more likely that his dua will be accepted. وصادف وقتا من الأوقات الإجابة الستة. And his dua that he makes turns out to be from the six times where a person's dua is accepted. وهي الثلث الأخير. The first time that he mentioned, brothers and sisters, is الثلث الأخير. A time that most of us, we might be very oblivious about and might not necessarily see the virtue of this time. It is the last third of the night. And it is the most difficult time for a person to wake up. And of course, do you think such a big fadila, virtue, is going to be attached to something that everybody might be able to do? There is certain people that have been chosen, brothers and sisters, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala specified in this dunya, handpicked to wake up in this night. And whoever isn't making up is really, really, brothers and sisters, missing out. Due to all the fada'il and the virtues that come with it, I really don't have the time to go through all of this. There's a lecture I have online where I talked about a lot of the fada'il of qiyamul layl and waking up in the last part of the night. But maybe a couple that we mentioned, inshaAllah ta'ala, is the famous hadith, يَنْزِلُ رَبُّنَا تَبَارَكَ وَتَعَالَى كُلَّ لَيْلَةٍ إِلَى السَّمَاءِ الدُّنْيَا. Your Lord, He comes down to the last heaven every single night. في ثلث الليل الأخير, in the last third of the night, where He remains and He says, مَنْ يَدْعُونِي فَأَسْتَجِبْ لَهُ. Who will call on to me so I can respond back to him? مَنْ يَسْأَلُنِي فَأَعْطِي. Who will ask me so I can respond back to the question that he has, the request that he has? مَنْ يَسْتَغْفِرُنِي فَأَغْفِرُ لَهُ. Who wants to seek my forgiveness so I can forgive him? A person, brothers and sisters, he combines between خَيْرَ الْخَيْرَاتِ in the last part of the night when he's praying. If a person now, he wakes up and he goes and starts praying, and at the same time in his sujood he's making a dua while he's in his posture of prostration, this person has now combined between a lot of khair. We know the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he told us, brothers and sisters, أَقْرَبُ مَا يَكُونُ الْعَبْدُ مِنْ رَبِّهِ وَهُ سَاجِدُ. The most closest that a person he gets to his Lord is while he is in his prostration. Then you have in another hadith where the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, أَلَا وَإِنِّي نُهِيتُ نَقْرَ الْقُرْآنَ رَاكِعًا وَسَاجِدًا فَأَمَّا الرُّكُوعَ فَعَظِّمُوا فِي الرَّبُّ وَأَمَّا السُّجُودُ فَاجْتَهِدُوا فِي الدُّعَى فَقَمِنُنَا يُسْتَجَابَ لَكُمْ. In your sujood, strive to make supplications and dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why? Because your dua will be responded back very, very quickly while you're in your sujood. And imagine now you're also in the last part of the night. Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he told us another hadith, أَقْرَبُ مَا يَكُونُ الرَّبُّ مِنَ الْعَبْدِ فِي جَوْفِ اللَّيْلِ الْأَخِيرِ. The closest that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala comes to the servant is in the last part of the night. فَإِنِ اسْتَطَعْتَ أَن تَكُونَ مِمَّا يَذْكُرُ اللَّهِ فِي تِلْكَ السَّاعَةِ فَكُنْ. If it is possible that you are from those who remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this hour, then be it. And he came in another narration as well, فَإِنَّ الصَّلَاةَ مَحْذُورَةٌ مَشْهُودَةٌ إِلَى طُلُوعِ الشَّمْسِ. The salah at this time, it is being witnessed. It is being witnessed at this time. تَحْذُورُهَا الْمَلَائِكَةُ وَتَشْهَدُهَا. The malaika, they come, they are present to it, and they are witnessing it. إِلَى طُلُوعِ الشَّمْسِ, until sunrise. So this is the first one, brothers and sisters. It came in another hadith, قِيلَ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ أَيُّ الدُّعَاءِ أَسْمَعُ. Which dua is أَقْرَبُ إِلَى الْإِجَابَةِ, as they explained it. Which dua, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is being asked, is most likely to be accepted, responded back to. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam responded back and he said, جَوْفَ اللَّيْلِ الْأَخِيرِ وَدُبَرَ الصَّلَوَاتِ. In the last part of the night, and also at the end of the salat. Anyway, we're going to come on to that, inshaAllah ta'ala. The second one that he mentions, brothers and sisters, is وَعِنْدَ الْآذَانِ, at the time of the adhan. The sunnah is, brothers and sisters, that a person he repeats after what the muadhin is saying, and then asks Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the wasila for the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and then he makes a dua. So it came in the hadith where the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, إِذَا سَمِعْتُمُ الْمُؤَذِّنَ فَقُولُوا مِثْلَ مَا يَقُولُ. When you hear the muadhin, then say exactly that which he says. Then say exactly that which he says. Except when it comes to the hay'ala, we say, لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله. As it came in the hadith, وَلِمُسْلِمٍ عن عمر القطاب رضي في فضل القول كما يقول المؤذن كلمة كلمة سوى الحيعلتين فيقول لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله. But then as it came in another narration, a person after the wasila as it came in the hadith where the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said in the hadith, ما سمع أحدكم المؤذن فقال مثل ما يقول. It came in the other hadith, ما منكم من أحد يسمع النداء فقال ما منكم من أحد يسمع النداء فقال اللهم رب هذه الدعوة التامة والصلاة القائمة آت محمد الوسيلة والفضيلة وابعثه مقاما محمودا الذي وعدته حلت له شفاعة يوم القيامة. Except that the شفاعة on يوم القيامة becomes incumbent upon this person. After that, a person, he makes the dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the second place where he mentioned that a person will get his dua accepted. Brothers and sisters, I'll mention another very nice latifa as well. Is, you know, subhanAllah, brothers and sisters, sometimes we look at the religion of Islam as something that asks us with very difficult amal, very, very difficult, you know, hard actions. And sometimes we tend to forget about maybe the small action that could be the reason why we enter into Al-Jannah. And one of these is to repeat after the muadhin. What is the fadila of just repeating after the muadhin? The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, after talking about what a person needs to say after the muadhin, فَقَالَ أَحَدُكُمْ اللَّهُ أَكْبَرُ اللَّهُ أَكْبَرُ ثُمَّ قَالَ أَشْهَدُ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ إِلَى آخِرِ الْحَدِيثِ. Where he says, مِنْ قَلْبِهِ دَخَلَ الْجَنَّةِ. Never does a person repeat after the muadhin, and he does this from his heart, except that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will enter him into Al-Jannah. A small action that it takes maybe a few minutes, brothers and sisters, but at the same time you do it with a present heart. Do you see how it could enter you into Al-Jannah? Shaykh Abdul Razak Al-Badr, one of the mashayikh of the Haram in Al-Madinah, he mentioned a very nice latifa. Shaykh bin Baz rahimahullah ta'ala was somebody who wouldn't ask, sorry, who wouldn't respond back or answer any questions at the time of the adhan. One time Sheikh Abdul Razak, he traveled to Riyadh. And at the time of the adhan, everybody had left Sheikh bin Baz. Nobody would ask him questions. So the Sheikh, he thought, okay, hadi fursa. This is now a chance for me to go to the Sheikh, who's always got people around him and he's very, very busy, me to ask him a question. He went up to him, the Sheikh refused to answer the question. And it doesn't require rocket science to understand why. This great fadila that has been mentioned with regards to just repeating the adhan. And now the Sheikh, he does the exact same thing. Before he's about to get off the chair, Sheikh Abdul Razak Al-Badr, he clearly mentions, guys, please, I will answer questions, but as soon as the adhan goes, I can't answer any questions. So he walks, people come rushing to him, refuses to answer the question. Why? Because of this hadith. They are all in dire need, hoping that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala enters them into Al-Jannah due to this small what? Action. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, hadith Jabir, كُلُّ مَعْرُوفٍ صَدَقَةً. Every good deed that you do is what? Is a type of sadaqah. Again, something very, very small. Came in another hadith of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, لَا تَحْخِرَنَّ مِنَ الْمَعْرُوفِ شَيْئًا وَلَوْ أَن تَلْقَ أَخَاكَ بِوَجْهٍ طَلْقٍ. Do not belittle any good deed, even if it is what? Meeting your brother with a smiling face. Came another hadith. Here, Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani rahimahullah, he put all these hadith together to try and show you maybe a small action that a person does, and not to belittle it or to overlook it. Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, hadith Abi Dharr, إِذَا طَبَقْتَ مَرَقَةً فَأَكْثِرْ مَأَهَا وَتَعَاهَا جِرَانَكَ. When you cook soup, فَأَكْثِرْ مَأَهَا, try and put as much water as you can. وتعاهد جيرانك. So you can go and give it to the jiran, the neighbors. Something that doesn't require a lot of effort. But we might really look down on and not take it very seriously and miss out on this great reward. Then he goes on to say, وَبَيْنَ الْآذَانِ وَالْإِقَامَةِ. Between the adhan and the iqamah. It's from the awqat, the times that a person gets his dua accepted. It came a hadith Anas radiallahu ta'ala anhu where he said, Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, الدُعَاءُ بَيْنَ الْآذَانِ وَالْإِقَامَةِ لَا يُرَدْ. أَخْرَجُ النَّسَاءِ وَغَيْرُهُ. The dua, the supplication that a person does between the adhan and the iqamah, it's not rejected. وَأَدْبَارِ الصَّلَوَاتِ الْمَكْتُوبَةِ. And at the end of the salat, at the time of the tashahud, after a person is done with the tashahud, a person, he goes and he makes dua. Again, this is something, brothers and sisters, that a lot of us, we overlook, or we tend to get bored at the time of, or at the end of the salat. When the imam is finished and we've done with our at-tahiyyat, we've done at-ta'awud, we've sought refuge from the four things, as it came in the hadith, we tend to get bored. We might even like totally lose concentration just before the salah. Came in the hadith Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, hadith Mas'ud, which teaches the tahiyyat, at-tahiyyatu lillahi wa salawatu wa tayyibat, salamu alayka ila akhir al-hadith. The messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he then said, ثُمَّ لِيَتَخَيَّرْ مِنَ الدُّعَاءِ أَعْجَبُهُ إِلَيْهِ. Then one should choose a dua that is befitting for him. And that brings me to a point, brothers and sisters, how sometimes we try to go out our way to make dua after the salah. Of course, you can make dua at any time of the day. At any time of the day. Hoping that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepts your dua and responds back to it. But now, why do we then miss out and overlook at times when the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam specified that there is more of a chance for your dua to be accepted? هذا في السجود, in the sujood. As I mentioned before, فَاجْتَهِدُوا فِي الدُّعَاءِ فَقَمِنُوا يُسْتَجَابَ لَكُمْ. Strive in making dua, for indeed your dua will quickly be responded back to. And also just before the end of the prayer, before a person does a taslim. These are two places that have been specifically mentioned. Why is it that we might go after the salah? Yes, it might be accepted, might not be accepted, but we miss out on this and then we go after that. And to such an extent, sometimes, subhanAllah, we leave of the adhkar. The Messenger كان النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم صرف من صلاتي استغفر الله ثلاثا. When he left, used to leave the prayer, he would do what? Istighfar three times. Again, this is the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that he used to act upon. We miss out on that and then we go and make dua. Instead, what is really much better, brothers and sisters, to do the dua in the salah and then follow the prophetic tradition of doing the istighfar and the at'iyah. And that a person also says, Allahumma inni ala dhikrika wa shukrika wa husni ibadatik. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Mu'ad ibn Jabal, inni uhibbuka fillah. La tada'anna dubra kulla salatin maktubatin an taqul, اللهم إني على ذكرك وشكرك وحسن عبادتك. I love you for the sake of Allah. إني أحبك في الله. Do not leave off saying this after every or the end of every single prayer. And then you have آية الكرسي. من قرأ آية الكرسي دبر كل صلاة مكتوبة لم يمنع من دخول الجنة إلى الموت. Whoever reads آية الكرسي after every single obligatory prayer, the only thing that stops him from getting into al-Jannah, brothers and sisters, is dying, death. Again, a very, very small action that takes just a few moments of our time. Let us not overlook this, brothers and sisters. Then the Shaykh, or Imam Ibn Qayyim, rahimahullah ta'ala, he says, وَعِنْدَ صُعُودِ الْإِمَامِ يَوْمَ الْجُمْعَةِ عَلَى الْمِنْبَرِ حَتَّى تُخْضَ الصَّلَاةِ. At the time when the Imam gets on the minbar, on the day of Al-Jum'ah, حَتَّى تُخْضَ الصَّلَاةِ, until the salah is finished. You know, some scholars, they say, brothers and sisters, they say that it's more recommended for the imam, when he sits in between the qutbas, not to be rushing to stand up again, but rather to, you know, take his time, or to spend that time, so that the musallin, they can go and make dua. Because it's one of the times when the dua gets accepted. As it came in the hadith, هي ما بين أن يجلس الإمام إلى أن تقضى الصلاة. It's from the time that the imam, he sits down until the salah is finished. Also, a very nice faida Sheikh Abdul Razak al-Badr, when he was going through, he mentioned was, the last sujood in the Salatul Jum'ah, brothers and sisters, is not like any other sujood. When a person makes dua. As I mentioned before, brothers and sisters, your dua is being accepted, right, at the time of the sujood. There's even now more of a chance of getting your dua accepted if a person makes dua in the last sujood of the Jum'ah prayer. Because of this hadith. And then he says, وَآخِرُ سَاعَةٍ بَعْدَ الْعَصْرِ مِنْ ذَلِكَ الْيَوْمِ. And the last hour of the day of Jum'ah, after Asr, that is the hour before Maghrib. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he mentioned a hadith of Abi Hurairah radiallahu ta'ala anhu, فيه ساعة لا يوافقها عبد مسلم وهو قائم يصلي يسأل الله عز وجل شيئا إلى أعطاه إياه وأشار بيده يقللها. There is an hour on the day of Jum'ah, لا يوافقها عبد مسلم وهو قائم يصلي, that the abd, that the servant, he makes a dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, يسأل الله عز وجل شيئا إلى أعطاه إياه. He asks Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for something, except that he will end up responding back to his dua. The last hour on Jum'ah, the hour before Maghrib. وصادف خشوعا في القلب وانكسارا بين يدي الرب وذلا له وتضرعا ورقة. And when a person now he makes his dua, brothers and sisters, he does it while his heart is present. It's concentrating. Not absent-minded or unmindful. He's making the dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala while his mind is thinking about his wife or the marriage meeting that he's going to be going on to or the food that he's going to be eating. But rather his concentration is full. Because the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did say, أُدْعُوا اللَّهَ وَأَنْتُمْ مُوقِنُونَ بِالْإِجَابَةِ. Make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala while you have certainty that your dua will be accepted. وَعْلَمُوا بِأَنَّ اللَّهَ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى لَا يَسْتَجِيبُ دُعَاءً مِنْ قَلْبٍ لَاهٍ غَافِلٍ. And also know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not respond back to in an individual whose heart is distracted. He isn't concentrating. His mind isn't present at the time of making dua. And then he says, وَانْكِسَارًا بَيْنَ يَدَيَ الرَّبِّ. To break down in front of your Lord. Wallahi, brother, it's really, really hard to put, you know, words or to explain this with words as how a person can really break down in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the one who has experienced this, he really knows what the intended purpose behind this is. To go and maybe seclude yourself in somewhere where there's nothing distracting you and to break down in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala just so he can respond back to some of the requests that you have and the problems that you're facing. وَذُلًّا لَهُ وَتَضَرُّعًا وَرِقَّةً. While at the same time a person, he is humiliating himself in front of Allah Azza wa Jal. He's in humiliation of Allah Azza wa Jal, afwan. He's in humiliation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon making this dua. And this is exactly what Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah ta'ala used to do. Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah ta'ala كَانَ يَتَمَرَّغُ عَلَى السَّعِيدِ كَمَا يَتَمَرَّغُ الدَّابَّةِ. He would roll himself on the floor, on the earth, the soil, out of humiliation to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When he needed something, he would roll himself, brothers and sisters, on the soil, showing his humility to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala so he can respond back to his dua. And he would say, Ya mu'allimu Daud, wa ya mufahimu Sulaiman, fahimni. O teacher of Daud, oh, the one who made Sulaiman alayhi salatu wasalam understand, please make me understand. Also Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah ta'ala, he mentions that sometimes Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah ta'ala, he would make istighfar over 1,000 times. Again, in humility of Allah Azza wa Jal. Just so what his dua can be accepted and his call can be responded back to. Anandaji Imam rahimahullah ta'ala, he mentions istiqbalu واستقبل الداعي القبلة. At the time of making dua, he faced the qibla. This is not from the things that causes a person's dua to be rejected, but rather it's from the etiquette of a dua. And he uses this proof, the hadith of when the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was in the battle of Badr. We know that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he only had 319 of his companions fighting against the mushrikeen. The mushrikeen Quraysh, they had 1,000. And it was at a time when things became really, really difficult for the Messenger sallallahu alayhi and his companions. إِذْ تَسْتَغِيثُونَ رَبَّكُمْ فَاسْتَجَابَ لَكُمْ أَنِّي مُمِدُّكُمْ بِأَلْفٍ مِنَ الْمَلَائِكَةِ مُرْدِفِينَ. When you were seeking aid and ghawth, asking Allah subhanahu to remove the difficulty and the hardship that you're going through. So Umar ibn al-Khattab radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, he narrates the hadith and he says, فَاسْتَقْبَلَ النَّبِيُّ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ الْقِبْلَةَ ثُمَّ مَدَّ يَدَيْهِ فَجَعَلَ يَهْتُفُ بِرَبِّهِ He faced the qibla, he stretched out his hands, and he made this dua, Allahumma anjiz li ma wa'adtani. Oh Allah, execute for me for that which you promised me. Allahumma aati ma wa'adtani. Oh Allah, give me that which you have promised. Allahumma in tuhlik hadhihi al-isabah min ahli al-islami la tu'badu fil ard. Oh Allah, if these companions, meaning those who were with the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, these people, were to be destroyed, then nobody would worship you on the face of this earth. فَمَا زَالَ يَهْتِفُ بِرَبِّهِ مَادًا يَدَيْهِ مُسْتَقْبِلَ الْقِبْلَةِ حَتَّى سَقَطَ رِضَاؤُهُ عَنْ مَنْكِبَيْهِ. And he kept on saying this, repeating this to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in humility, and he left his hands outstretched to such an extent that the rida, the upper garment that he was wearing, it dropped off him. And he kept on repeating this from his shoulders. Imam An-Nawawi rahimahullah ta'ala, he says, فيه استحباب واستقبال القبلة في الدعاء. This shows the istihbab, the recommendation of facing the qibla at the time of dua. ورفع اليدين فيه, and also raising your hands. وكان على طهارة. He also mentions, Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah, he carries on and says, at the same time he is upon tahara. He is upon tahara. And the proof of this is hadith al-Muhajir ibn Khunfud, annahu sallama ala Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, wa huwa yatawadda, falam yarudda alayhi hatta tawadda. He one time entered upon him and he gave salam to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, at this time he was making wudu. He never returned back the salam until he finishes wudu. فَرَدَّ عَلَيْهِ وَقَالَ. So Al-Muhajir, he responded, he said to him, عفوا, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi responded back to him and he said, إِنَّهُ لَمْ يَمْنَعْنِي أَنْ أَرُدَّ عَلَيْكَ. The only thing that prevented me from responding back to you was, إِنِّي كَرِهْتُ أَنْ أَذْكُرَ اللَّهُ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى إِلَّا عَلَى طَهَارَةٍ. It's because I dislike remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala except that I am upon tahara. Hassan al-Basri rahimahullah ta'ala, tabi'i, commented and he said, إِنِّي أَكْرَهُ أَنْ أَقْرَأَ وَأَذْكُرُ اللَّهَ عَزَّ وَجَلْ حَتَّى أَتَطَهَرُ. I dislike to read the Quran and also to remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala until I make wudu. Until I make wudu. Again, this is from the adab and from the things that increase a person's chances of getting his dua accepted. وَرَفَعَ يَدَيْهِ إِلَى اللَّهِ تَعَالَى. And then he mentions the next point is, when making dua that a person puts his hands up to Allah Azza wa Jal. Based on the hadith of Salman ibn al-Farisi radiallahu ta'ala anhu, إِنَّ رَبَّكُمْ حَيٌّ كَرِيمٌ يَسْتَحِي مِنْ عَبْدِهِ إِذَا رَفَعَ يَدَيْهِ إِلَيْهِ يَرُدُمَا سِفْرًا. أي خائبتين خرج الأربعة إلى النسائي. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is shy and he is generous that when his servant now stretches out his hands to him, that he sends him back empty-handed. Well, I sometimes feel like some of us, we feel a bit embarrassed to stretch out our hands amongst people or amongst the congregation. وكيف ذلك? And why is this, brothers and sisters? When the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is clearly telling us that it's a means of getting your dua accepted. Even on the day of Arafah, كان النبي سيرفع يديه إلى صدره يدعو من بعد الظهر إلى غروب الشمس. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would raise his hands from the time of Dhuhr, بعد الظهر إلى غروب الشمس, until sunset. وبدأ بحمد الله والثناء عليه ثم ثنى بالصلاة على محمد عبده ورسوله. And then at the time of making dua, he starts up with alhamd, by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, ثم الثناء عليه, he follows up with thana. The difference between alhamd and thana is alhamd is to praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The word thana is used when the hamd is repeated. When a person now follows up a praise with another praise, it is called a thana. And then after that, he sends his salutations upon the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It came in a hadith of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, أنه سمع رجلا يدعو في صلاته لم يحمد الله ولم يصلي على النبي sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. فقال عجل هذا. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, one time he heard an individual praying. He didn't do alhamd. He didn't start off by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he didn't also what? Send his salutation upon the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. فَقَالَ عَجِلَ هَذَا. This individual was hasty. ثُمَّ دَعَى النَّبِي sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said to him, إِذَا صَلَّ أَحَدُكُمْ فَلْيَبْدَ بِتَحْمِيدِ رَبِّي وَالثَّنَاءِ عَلَيْهِ ثُمَّ يَدْعُو بِمَا شَاءَ ثُمَّ لِيُصَلِّ عَلَى النَّبِي sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ثُمَّ يَدْعُو بِمَا شَاءَ. If any of you praise, start with the hamd. Also send your salutations upon the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and then make your dua. So they took from this that if a person wants to increase his chances of getting his dua accepted, he starts off with this manner. By al-thana, al-hamd, thumma al-thana, thumma ba'da dalik, as-salat ala nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he sends his salutations. Thumma qaddama bayna yaday hajati at-tawbata wal-istighfar. And then before he starts his dua, brothers and sisters, he mentions before it his, you know, he asks Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for forgiveness and mentions his sins to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wal istighfar, and also by seeking, doing istighfar. And this one, brothers and sisters, is vital. Why? The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he told us, دعوة ذنون إذ دعا وهو في بطن الحوت. The supplication of ذنون, Yunus عليه الصلاة والسلام, when he supplicated and he was in the stomach of the whale. لا إله إلا أنت سبحانك إني كنت من الظالمين. Saying the supplication, Allah says to us in the Quran, وذنون إذ ذهب مغاضبا فظن أن لن نقدر عليه فنادى في الظلمات أن لا إله إلا أنت سبحانك إني كنت من الظالمين فاستجبنا له. ونجيناه من الغم. When Yunus alayhi salatu wasalam was swallowed up by the whale, he called out and he said, لا إله إلا أنت سبحانك. No one has the right to be worshipped and true except you, and glory be to you. سبحانك. He said, تنزيه. إني كنت من الظالمين. I was from those who oppressed themselves. فاستجبنا له ونجيناه من الغم. Hey, the difference in the Arabic language, brothers, is between فاء and واو, أن الفاء يفيد التعقيب. يعني something happening straight away. So Allah says, فاستجبنا. We answer this call straight away. ونجيناه من الغم. And we saved him from the distress that he was in. If I say, for example, now, جاء in the Arabic language, it means what? He came. جاء محمد وعمر. Muhammad came and Amr came as well. Wow, it means and. Muhammad came and then Amr. We don't necessarily know if he came straight away or came like 2 hours later. If you say, جاء محمد وعمر, he could have come maybe at 3 o'clock, Muhammad, and then a couple of hours later, Umar came, and still the ma'na is sahih. But if I say, جاء محمد فعمر, Muhammad and Amr came, and I put the fa in between, it means he followed up and he came straight away. So here the Messenger of Allah further explained, he said, فَإِنَّهُ لَمْ يَدْعُ بِهَا رَجُلٌ مُسْلِمٌ فِي شَيْءٍ قَطْ إِلَّا إِسْتَجَابَ اللَّهُ لَهُ. Never does a person make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with this dua, إِلَّا إِسْتَجَابَ اللَّهُ لَهُ, except that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will respond back to him straight away. The poet, he says, وَسَلْ مِنْ رَبِّكَ التَّوْفِيقَ فِيهَا وأخلص في السؤال إذا سألت ونادي إذا سجدت له اعترافا بما ناداه ذو النون ابن متى ولازم بابه قرعا عساه سيفتح بابه لك إن قرعت. Ask your Lord for a tawfiq when you ask. وأخلص في السؤال إذا سألت, and be sincere upon asking this سؤال. ونادي إذا سجدت له اعترافا, and when you prostrate, call out to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala admitting your sins. بما ناداه ذو النون ابن متى, that which Dhunnun, Yunus alayhi salatu wasalam, supplicated Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with. Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah ta'ala, he says something very powerful commenting on this dua. He said, فَمَا دُفِعَتْ شَدَائِدُ الدُّنْيَا بِمِثْلِ التَّوْحِيدِ. There is nothing like removing the difficulties and the distresses that a person is going through in this dunya than what having a tawheed. ولذلك كان دعاء الكرب بالتوحيد ودعوة ذي النون التي ما دعا بها مكروب. And this is why the دعاء الكرب بالتوحيد, calling unto Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the time of difficulty with the توحيد. لا إله إلا أنت, the توحيد, right? ودعوة ذي النون, and the دعاء of Yunus عليه الصلاة والسلام, ذي النون التي ما دعا بها مكروب. There's not a time when a person is going through calamities that he makes this دعاء إلا فرج الله كربه, except that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will remove the difficulty that he's going through. بالتوحيد. فلا يلقى في الكرب العظام إلا الشرك ولا ينجى منها إلا التوحيد. And a person doesn't fall into difficulties and distresses and from the major of the difficulties that he's going through except due to a shirk, right? ولا ينجي منها إلا التوحيد. And that which removes the difficulty that a person is going through is a tawheed. Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah ta'ala, he said, إِنَّ الْمَسْأَلَةَ لَتُغْلَقُ عَلَيَّ. He is trying to understand a issue of the deen, but he just finds that the doors get closed. He can't understand anything. فَأَسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهَ أَلْفَ مَرَّةٍ. So I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for forgiveness 1,000 times. أو أكثر أو أقل, sometimes more and sometimes less. فيفتحها الله علي. Allah سبحانه وتعالى just totally opens it up for me. فقلت استغفروا ربكم إنه كان غفارا. The point is, brothers and sisters, here he's making استغفار to Allah عز وجل. That proves us the point that I mentioned of when Ibn al-Qayyim said that when a person, before he makes dua, before that, before his hajid and need that he makes dua for, he does a tawbah والاستغفار. He asks Allah for forgiveness and he does istighfar. There's just a couple of points left, inshallah ta'ala. ثُمَّ دَخَلَ عَلَى اللَّهِ, and then after that he starts his dua. وَأَلَحَّ عَلَيْهِ فِي الْمَسْأَلَةِ وَتَمَلَّقَهِ. This individual, brothers and sisters, he urgently beseeches Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and constantly repeats it, breaks down, asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala without getting exasperated or becoming bored. With a present heart that a person makes his dua with. ودعاه رغبة ورهبة. And while he makes dua with رغبة and رهبة, hoping and fearing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, while he makes this dua. This dua, brothers and sisters, is ibadah. We know that when we worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we worship Him in between fear and what hope. Whatever action that we do, we hope that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepts it from us. And at the same time, we are fearful that it doesn't get accepted. And this is how the companions, they used to be. They never knew as to whether their actions used to be accepted or not. And at the same time, they hope, inshallah ta'ala, our actions will be accepted. Because the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what did he say? الدعاء هو العبادة. The dua is the ibadah. وتوسل إليه بأسمائه وصفاته وتوحيده. When making dua, brothers and sisters, again, this is a means of getting your dua accepted. He does it with the names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala وتوحيده. And it's توحيد. Allah says in the Quran, وَلِلَّهِ الْأَسْمَاءُ الْحُسْنَى فَادْعُوهُ بِهَا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has names and attributes, and call unto Allah Azza wa Jal with it. If you want the rizq, Ya Razzaq. Ya Razzaq. What does Ya Razzaq mean? Sighatul mubalagha fi i'ta' al-rizq. Somebody who excessively gives out the provision, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is as such. You want the rizq, you use the name that is munasib for it. The name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that is what? Convenient for the situation. He has 99 names and more. So with the situation that you're in, use the specific name. Like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when they said to the people of Shu'aib, said to him, قَالَ الْمَلَأُ الَّذِينَ اسْتَكْبَرُوا مِنْ خَوْمِي لَنُخْرِجَنَّكَ يَا شُعَيْبُ وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا مَعَكَ مِنْ قَرْيَتِنَا أَوْ لَتُعُودُنَّ فِي مِلَّتِنَا قَالَ أَوْ لَوْ كُنَّا كَارِهِينَ. قَدْ افْتَرَيْنَا. Until where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, quotes Shu'aib alayhi salatu wasalam, رَبَّنَا افْتَحْ بَيْنَنَا وَبَيْنَ قَوْمِنَا بِالْحَقِّ وَأَنْتَ خَيْرُ الْفَاتِحِينَ. He said, oh Allah, open the situation up for us. أَنْتَ خَيْرُ الْفَاتِحِينَ. You are the best of those who make openings. And then this is the last point that he mentioned. وَقَدَّمَ بَيْنِ يَدَيْ دُعَاهِ صَدَقَةً. And before his dua, he pays charity. SubhanAllah, before we took this point with the Shaykh, the night before that I read it and I just couldn't get my head around it. And I tried to think about where's the proof and the evidence that a person, if he wants his dua being accepted, that he pays sadaqah. And the reality of the matter is, it could be understood that one, before he makes dua, he goes and pays sadaqah. But the intended purpose is not as such. And the Shaykh Hafidhullah Ta'ala explained this. He brought the hadith of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وَمَا تَقَرَّبَ إِلَيَّ عَبْدِي بِشَيْءٍ أَحَبَّ إِلَيْ مِمَّا افْتَرَدْتُهُ عَلَيْهِ وَمَا يَزَالُ عَبْدِي يَتَقَرَّبُ إِلَيْ بِالنَّوَافِلِ حَتَّى أُحِبَّهُ. That which is most beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that gets you close to Him, brothers and sisters, is to come with the wajibat, that which is wajib, that which Allah Azza wa Jalla has placed an obligation on your neck. And then a person gets even more close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with what? With a nawafil. Hatta uhibba, until Allah Azza wa Jalla loves him. فَإِذَا أَحْبَبْتُ كُنْتُ سَمْعُ الَّذِي يَسْمَعُ بِهِ وَبَصَرُ الَّذِي يَبْصُرُ بِهِ وَيَدُ الَّذِي يَبْطِشُ بِهَا وَرِجْلُهُ الَّذِي يَمْشِي بِهَا وَإِنْ سَأَلَنِي لَأَعْطَيْتُهُ. And when he asks me, I give him whatever he wants. And we know that sadaqah, what, is a very virtuous supererogatory act, to be giving sadaqah. So the Shaykh subhanAllah, he took from this that here the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is saying in the hadith, a person keeps getting closer to Allah Azza wa Jal to such an extent that he really loves him. And when he does make dua, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepts his call straight away. وَلِنْ إِسْتَعَاذَنِي لَوْعِيذَنَّ. And when he seeks my aid, I aid him and assist him straight away. Through what? As-sadaqah. That a person regularly, not specifying for this very moment, but just generally he pays sadaqah all the time. Obviously, this is after he's done his wajibat. And because of this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will accept what? The dua when he makes. And then he concludes and he says, brothers and sisters, فَإِنَّ هَذَا الدُّعَاءَ لا يكاد يرد أبدا. This type of supplication is barely ever rejected. ولا سيما إن صادف الأدعية التي أخبر النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أنها مضنة الإجابة أو أنها متضمنة للإسم الأعظم. Especially at a time when a person he supplicates Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with a dua that the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم told us is more likely to be accepted. Or it consists of the great name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I'll give you an example. Hadith Buraydah radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Anna Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sami'a rajulan yaqul Allahumma inni yas'aluka bi anni ashhadu annaka anta al-ahad as-samad alladhi lam yalid wa lam yulad wa lam yakun lahu kufuwan ahad. Faqala Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam laqad sa'ala Allah bi ismihi alladhi idha su'ila bi a'ta wa idha du'i bi ajab. Here the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam heard an individual supplicate اللهم إني أسألك بأني أشهد أنك أنت الأحد الصمد. Oh Allah, I ask you that I am somebody who bears witness that nobody has the right to be worshipped. وأنت الأحد الصمد الذي لم يلد ولم يولد. That you are the أحد, the one and only, الصمد. هو الذي يصمد إليه الخلائق في جميع حوائجهم. صمد is a person who the people come to in order to fulfill their needs. They rise up to him in order to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for their needs in order for it to be fulfilled. الَّذِي لَمْ يَلِدْ وَلَمْ يُولَدْ وَلَمْ يَكُنْ لَهُ كُفُوًا أَحَدٌ. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he commented, لَقَدْ سَأَلَ اللَّهِ. He has asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with a dua. إِذَا سُئِلَ بِهِ أَعْطَى. When he's asked, he gives. وَإِذَا دُعِي بِأَجَاب. And when he is supplicated, he responds back to it. As for the Ism al-A'zam, to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with his great name, or the greatest name, it was narrated by Imam al-Tirmidhi rahimahullah ta'ala, that Asma bint Yazid, she said, أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال, اسم الله الأعظم في هاتين الآيتين. The great name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is in these two verses. وَإِلَهُكُمْ إِلَهٌ وَاحِدٌ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّهُ الرَّحْمَنُ الرَّحِيمُ وَفَاتِحَةَ آلِ عِمْرَانِ. So here in this verse, brothers and sisters, لا إله إلا هو الرحمن الرحيم. الرحمن الرحيم was mentioned as the great name. And also آل عمران, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, الله لا إله إلا هو الحي القيوم. And that the great names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the best of it is الحي القيوم. And this is what Ibn al-Qayyim, even though there's such a big اختلاف, or what, which one is the great name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Messenger was talking about if a person was to supplicate Allah azza wa jalla with, that his dua would be accepted. There's a lot of riwayat that mention different things. Some of them they say it's Allahu ila ghayri thalik. So subhanAllah, Shaykh Abdul Razak al-Badr, he mentioned, there is no loss. As long as a person, he's mentioning all of these names that the scholars have differed as to which is the best name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he supplicates Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with it. Sometimes this, sometimes that, sometimes, and he doesn't do that. Why? Because all of this, they fall under the hadith, al-ism al-a'zam, because that's what the narration states. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, brothers and sisters, to benefit us from what we heard. Allahumma aati nufusana taqwaha wa zakkiha anta khayru man zakkaha anta waliyuha wa mawlaha. It's a supplication that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to make dua, asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to purify his hearts. To purify his heart. And we know that he had athar al-qulub. He had the most pure of hearts. Where do any of us stand? Our hearts have become so damaged and they've died. So blackened, we sin on a regular basis. Let us make this dua all the time, hoping that Allah, through it, he will purify our hearts. It's a common question that comes all the time. Brother, my heart is dead. I don't feel any sort of iqdam, iqbal, going forth to the things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants me to do. I feel this type of coldness, estrangement between me and Allah azza wa jal, alienation. There's people who feel like that because of the sins that has tied them up. Maybe something to start with by making this dua in the month of Ramadan. Allahumma aati nafsi taqwaha wa zakkiha anta khayru man zakkaha. Oh Allah, bless me with taqwa in my heart. Wa zakkiha, purify it, for indeed you are the best of those who purify. Anta waliyuha wa mawlaha. You are its guardian and you are its protector. Subhanaka Allahumma bihamdik. أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك وأتوب إليك. Apologies for, I think I went well over the time. Inshallah, maybe next week we'll, you know, shorten it. لكن I felt like this was a very, I could have really gone on. There's so many other stuff to mention, but I just didn't get the time. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.